Hello everyone. Before we begin, if you can all please confirm that you can hear me and see the slides clearly by just typing yes in the chat window. Also, please feel free to introduce yourself, your name, position, company, and which country you are based in. It's great to see an international audience of people from all industries and backgrounds. Pleasure to meet you all. Okay, great. Thanks for the confirmation. So first of all, I'd like to thank you all for registering and taking time out on a Saturday to learn about fire protection engineering and design, which itself shows that you're all high achievers and interested in expanding your technical knowledge. We hope by the end of this webinar, you'll have gained good knowledge about the fundamentals of fire protection engineering and design. So, as some of you may already know, this is our 26th webinar in a series of technical webinars we are conducting. So please follow us on LinkedIn and make sure to check out our website to stay tuned to our latest updates. So today's webinar is being jointly hosted by Veloci and HTM together. So today's webinar will be most beneficial for fire protection, design, HSE, and process engineers and managers. So my name is Mohammed Jaffer, and I'm the Business Development Manager at Veloci. We have quite an experienced panel of speakers here for you today. I'm with my colleagues, Mr. Ajaz, Mr. Tony, Mr. Farooq, and Mr. Farasat, who are all experts in this field with a collective experience of over 50 years. So you are all in good hands today. During this webinar, we encourage you all to keep asking questions to clear any doubts. This can not only help you, but may also, and also many others who can usually have the same doubts. You can type your queries in the Q&A window and you'll either receive a reply in the window or live if we feel it is something important that will benefit everyone. So we'll try to answer questions at the end of each section. Please make sure to ask your queries in the Q&A window and not the chat window. We'll have a detailed Q&A session at the second hour of this webinar. Please accept our apologies if your questions are not addressed due to the high volume of questions usually received. We'll also be issuing participation certificate to all those who have attended at least 80% of this webinar and have participated in the discussions throughout the Q&A. Since this is quite a technical subject, and today we'll be touching key theoretical and practical aspects of fire protection engineering and design in this limited time of 2 hours, we request you all to follow along with us, keep asking questions to help us in making this as engaging as possible. So today's webinar is based on a case study that we have conducted previously for a refinery. Please note that the client's name and data have been redacted. We'll be following a practical approach where we'll walk you through the key steps throughout this case study. The main goal is by the end of this webinar, you'll have a good understanding about the relevant codes, standards, design criteria, significance, and practicality of various fire protection systems. Before we begin, although most of us are in the comfort of our home, we should be aware of the emergency exits. Due to the current COVID-19 situation, we should keep a safe distance and in general take care of ourselves and those around us. Now, as I've already told you, today's webinar is jointly hosted by Veloci and HTM. I'll start by giving a brief introduction about Veloci and what we do. Veloci is a leading global consulting firm that provides asset integrity management, HSE, engineering, environmental, and software solutions to clients in the oil and gas, energy, power, and petrochemical industries around the world. We also have our in-house proprietary software, Veilplant, which is an industry-leading SAP-certified complete asset integrity solution software, which has been used by oil and gas giants such as ADNOC, Dragon Oil, TANAP, and many more to the list. Now, founded in 1982, we have expanded our footprint to more than 38 countries worldwide, offering a full range of specialized consulting services tailored to the energy needs. It is a map showing our worldwide existence. By combining global coverage and local knowledge with our wide range of services, we are able to create tailored solutions to complex problems. Our range of interrelated services and integrated approach ensures that we can accommodate a wide range of services. Now, we provide services covering a broad range of industries like oil refineries, GOSPs, gas and NGL plants, chemical plants, fertilizer plants, pipelines, offshore platforms, wellheads, and structures. Now, let me go into a little detail of the services that we provide. Now, starting with the asset integrity management services, we provide risk-based inspection, pipeline integrity management system for onshore and offshore, structural integrity management system, pressurized equipment management system, inspection scheduling management system, wellhead integrity management system, asset performance management system, computerized maintenance management system, ISO 55001, which is asset management system, safety integrity level, liability-centered maintenance, liability availability and maintainability, NDT testing, condition-based monitoring, technical trainings, DCBG and CIP service. Now our HSCI division, we provide HSCI studies, process safety and risk studies, which involves workshop facilitation, risk assessment, HOMA safety cases, health safety and environmental critical equipment system, drilling HSE consultancy services. Then we have the environmental studies, under which we do environmental impact assessment, environmental management plans, environmental compliance audits, environmental modeling and assessments, environmental monitoring and testing. Now we also provide occupational health risk assessment, under which we provide emergency management and planning, qualitative OHRA, quantitative ORA, workplace exposure monitoring, industrial hygiene monitoring plan. We also provide engineering services, under which we provide conceptual design feed, detailed design and engineering consultancy services, operating manuals and procedures, design verification and appraisal, fitness for service, as-built drafting services, project management consultancy services. Then we have our software solution, under which we provide Vail Plant, which is a complete asset integrity management system. Then we have the Vail PHA, which is process hazard analysis, which we use for the hazard pencil studies. Then we have the Vail PSRA, which is specific to petrol station risk assessment. Then we have Vail MTS, Vail ERP, Vail CTR, Vail Flow, and Vail ORP. Now these are various inspection equipment that we use for various inspections. For example, for the magnetic flux leakage tank bottom inspection, we use the floor map, 3D IMR. For coating thickness measurement, we use electrocyclic many test 745. For the corrosion under insulation, we use the Edify lift. For the long range UT guided wave, we use the Teletest Focus Plus. Then for ultrasonic thickness measurement, we use Olympus 38DL Plus and GE DMS. For positive material identification, we use Olympus XRF analyzer. For tank field inspection, we use Edify V750 vacuum box. Now, Velocity has successfully executed 600 projects with 300 clients, including ADNOC, Dragon Oil, Saudi Aramco, Lukoil, CAFCO, Petronas, Repsol, Orpec, and many more to the list. These are the various certifications, accreditations and approval, and memberships that Velocity has. Now, let me give you a brief introduction of H2AM. Now, founded in 2015, H2AM is the manufacturing and trading arm of the group, dealing with fire engineering, fire safety and protection equipments, PPEs, NDT equipment, manpower supply, and trainings. Now, there is a map showing our worldwide presence. Now, these are the various products and services that we provide. We provide fire protection engineering and design, firefighting equipment, personal protective equipments, NDT equipment, equipment and hardware tools, industry safety trainings, and technical manpower supply. Now, so we are the authorized distributors for over 35 brands all over the world, and these are some of them. Now, here are some of our clients that we have worked with over the years. Now, these are the various design standards that we adopt. We use the NFPA, which is the National Fire Protection Association, ISO 9001, American Petroleum Institute, and Pakistan Engineering Council. Now, I'll request Mr. Ijaz to continue with today's topic.
Good day, and assalamu alaikum, everyone. So we start the topic. Like, what is fire? This is a basic definition. Fire is a chemical reaction involving rapid oxidation or a combustion of a fuel or combustible material. As we all know, there are three basically called sides of a fire, or three angles of a fire, which called number one combustible material, which is called fuel, number two oxygen or air, and number three the ignition source. So these three things are required to start any fire: fuel, oxygen, heat or ignition source. The classification of the fires can be various grades are there, like A, B, C, D or K, right? And these are defined as like normal class A fire is ordinary combustible materials, which is wood, paper or cloth. Then B is flammable liquids like grease, oil, paint or solvents. Then C is electrical, which are electrical panels and substations, etc. Then D is combustible material, metals basically, magnesium, aluminium, etc. And others are commercial cooking equipment like cooking oil, animal fats and vegetable oils. And there are fires which are associated with the hydrocarbons or petrochemical plants. These fires generally depends upon the type of the hydrocarbon, whether it's a liquid or a gas, and then what kind of pressure is there and what the volume. So these fires are generally considered as like a driver is coming from their like the nature of pressure behind the pressure containment equipment. Like jet fires, which are generally in the high pressure gas networks. And if any fire starts from a pipeline which is carrying a gas with high pressure, so the jet fire may impact a few meters away from the source of the hydrocarbon containment. Secondly, unconfined vapor cloud fires or flash fires. These fires are like which normally occurs as a liquid spaces are there. And third one is a pool fires, which are normally under the like hydrocarbon pool is there, or there is a some kind of like dikes around the tanks. Those fires are called normally pool fires. Running liquid fires, three-dimensional fires, if that could be under the pipelines or it could be a drainage system. Then boiling liquid expanding vapors, blavy, or fireballs. The fourth one also is there, which is a boil over. The boiling liquid called blavy, and boil over is if there is a water below the oil, and that water may start boiling earlier than oil, and then it carries out basically liquid, hydrocarbon liquid along with it and through a distance, and that's called a boil over. And that fire scenario is normally on the tank form. Fire, see, the first two things, like we are saying, what are the type of fires? A class fire, B class fire, C class fire, D class fire, or K class fire. We need to know about this. Like the type of the fires are there. And those fires, when we need to prevent them or we need to extinguish them, so there would be a different kind of firefighting agents requirements would be there. So that basically equation we need to remember. Second thing, we are going specific to hydrocarbons. So we can see there are various types of the fires are there in hydrocarbons. So we may need a different kind of firefighting agents or mechanisms to firefight those fires. Now we are going there, what are the firefighting agents? If we got a various kind of fires, how those fires can be fought, it could be prevented or it could be mitigated. The first agent is water, then foam, then CO2, dry chemicals and clean agents. So we'll be going through all these details. Like water is normally a main agent, but it's normally cooling, smoothening, dilution, it may help us to dilute the exposure of the fire as well. It is a low cost, normally available, but it cannot be applied for all the fires. And there are limitations about the freezing temperatures as well. Second is the foam. This is a more common fire. For these two, water and foam are two main firefighting agents which are used across the industry of the petrochemicals. And but this is applicable, foam is mostly applicable for the class B fires. Then third one is the clean agents, which is FM 200, right? And these fires are normally used for electrical substations or control rooms. So if we normally consider, like in the industry, which are the most commonly used firefighting agents, those are water, foam, cleaning agent. You also find dry chemicals everywhere, the dry chemical filled in the baskets and kept around the area. And then CO2 is also used sometime. So the combination point of view, if you see your first slide, there are class A fire, class B fire, class C fire, class D, electrical and F. K is not shown here, but in general, these are the like agents and how they are effective. If you see class A fire, combustible material, water is more effective. Foam is effective for class A and class B, like combustible material and flammable liquids as well. Dry powder, this is the most commonly, like it's effective for most of the fires, even electrical, class D, class C. But the question is how you can throw the dry powder, whether we would be able to cover the complete surface where the fire is taking place. Then CO2, this is applicable, but like if you can eliminate the oxygen from the area of the fire, then CO2 is more effective. Like class B fires and electrical fire, CO2 is effective. Then wet chemicals, these are basically the combustible materials, like there are chemicals which can help to eliminate the oxygen from the area. So these are most effective for the class F, deep fat fryers, like, and the class A. This. Fundamentals of the fire protection. Previously, we covered through the general concept of the firefighting. Now we'll see how the role of various code and practices and standards is there to guide us how we can design or do engineering for firefighting systems. See, the importance of fire, basically protection. Yes, sir. For a fire protection, there's an incident, right? For example, like there's one example in 1984, there was a fire incident in Mexico, and it caused basically various, like if you see incident, resulted in 650 fatalities and more than 6,400 injuries, and it also destructed a lot of property there. So lesson learned was like how such kind of incident can be minimized, or if incident happens, how we can control it, or its spread could be mitigated, or how we can react to the emergency situation. So this is a lesson learned, and then accordingly the code and standards has been updated in the across the industry, and lesson learned are being applied. There are various applicable standards, which is NFP is the most common one, National Fire Protection Association of America. These are the standards, one few of them, like NFPA 10, 11, 12, 13 to NFPA 2001, which is a clean agent for fire extinguishing systems. And NFPA 13 is a installation of sprinkler system. NFPA 15 is basically fixed spray systems. And NFPA 11 is normally for the foam system, and NFPA 30 for the flammable and combustible liquid and the other standards. So there are various like codes are there. These are not only all, we have only listed few. Then there are also API guidelines or standards which are available, and these are published by API, is American Petroleum Institute. And these are not all the standards. There are some of them we have listed here, and these standards works hands in hand with NFPA, like API RP 2001 fire protection in refinery, API RP 2218 is fire proofing, basically is a fire prevention under. Then API RP 2021 management of storage tanks fires. Then API RP 2030 is fixed water sprinkler system. which is basically a supplement for the NFPA 15. And similarly, IP standards are there. There are many IP standards regarding ingress control or basically safety of the panels or electrical systems. So IP 15 is area classification for the basically, this is the same like API 500 or API 505 nowadays. This has a area classification for electrical systems. So IP 15 is one of the most commonly used standard along with API 505. And then IP 19, fire protection at petroleum refineries and bulk storage installations is also commonly used. But there is IP 56, IP 60, IP 65. So various IP standards are there. So we have listed only a few which are helpful while designing or working on the fire protection systems. So there's also one more standard, which is UL under Ryder Laboratories. Those standards are also there for fire rating, basically actions, and those standards are also not listed in our presentation here. Fire protection versus prevention. So like two concepts, like if you say, first thing is a fire protection and second is a prevention. The science of reducing loss of life and property from fire by control and extinguishment. So this is the science which is called fire protection. Fire protection includes fire prevention, detection of a fire, providing system to control or mitigate the fire, and providing manual firefighting capabilities. Whereas fire prevention activities whose purpose is to prevent fire from starting. Fire protection and fire prevention go hand in hand. All fire protection programs include a fire prevention program. For example, control of ignition source is very important in minimizing the risk of a fire, but it does not meet the definition of fire protection in the guideline. But prevention is required. So prevention and protection both work side by side. And it's a further example is while designing a hydrocarbon facility, so we take care all precautions at the construction stage or the design stage of the facilities so as fire should not break out. So that's called basically fire prevention at a first stage. But if fire starts, then how we have to prevent it further from its spreading? That's called fire protection. So these two understandings has to be there in mind when we are working at fire engineering and design works. Fire protection strategy. Strategy point of view, the same thing like how we would be able to protect or prevent the fire. So there are stages what we need to follow. Just take an example, like all hydrocarbon facilities, they are having normally hydrocarbon in the pipes and pressure vessels. And there are some heaters also there, which are heating the oil. It means fire is also there inside the premises of the refinery. And similarly, there are electrical installations like light or the motors or power supply. So those things can also be a source of ignition. So the issue is you got a hydrocarbon inside the equipment, oxygen is available around in the air, and then there is a ignition source also could be available around. But we need to detach three of them. So three of them should not be coming together, because if the hydrocarbon, oxygen, and ignition source comes together, then fire will start and the complete refinery or hydrocarbon installation can go into flames and the whole investment could be lost. So to control those activities, so there are strategies, and those strategies are objective is like a protection of the personnel is considered in the design of the fire protection system. Credible hazards have been identified, assessed, understood, and documented. Every opportunity to minimize the hazards has been identified and considered, and where practical implemented, capital investment and estimated operating expenses to optimize with a view to minimize hazards is done. Corporate goals can be met for the facility lifetime, and potential adverse effects on neighbors, community, and the environments are controlled. Now, if I see the same aspect, like when we are designing the hydrocarbons facilities, there's a pressure containment, it means ASME code, is used, or electrical system point of view, IEC standards are used, instrumentation point of view, ISA standards are used, and so as we have basically proper design of the facilities. Similarly, to prevent excess of fires to the hydrocarbon areas, the heaters are at least they're installed 50 feet away from any other pipe or normal equipment. Similarly, all electrical installations, the hazard area classification is done, and it is ensured that the equipments are installed as per the applicable zones, like zone 0, zone 1, and zone 2. So as the ignition sources are not igniting the fire in case if there's some leakage of hydrocarbon take place. So in general terms, there is a risk management system or philosophy, like for example, in ADNOC here, or if you go to Shell or BP, they try to establish safety cases. In the safety cases means the all the hazards which are associated with the industry are listed, their mitigation and preventive plans are discussed, the risks are assessed, and then accordingly, the all preventive measures are in place with reference to the strategies. The first is a risk management philosophy, means they will be identifying the all hazards, and those hazards would be controlled or mitigated. And then the strategies would be in place, like if you see inherent safe design, process safety management, project design reviews, safety management systems, risk assessments, then emergency responses, and fire protection system. So these all like as a part of a fire protection strategy, basically is developed and implemented in a systematic way. This is like how we ensure that we don't get any extra risk for our facilities and for the investors. Similarly, various procedures are developed and those are in place and those are implemented during the plant operations, and various firefighting systems like foam system, like fire water, these are systems and their controls are basically in place. Like if the fireproofing is required or maintenance is required, water sprinkler system is installed, fire detection systems are installed, fire water distribution networks are developed and implemented, and these are the basically gaseous systems which are implemented for the control rooms and power stations. So install system versus emergency response, like firefighting or fire protection is done in basically three ways. Number one, active fire protection. Number two, passive fire protection. And number three, emergency response. So when we say active fire protection, those are the firefighting systems, like the active fire protection, passive fire protection. And there's also emergency response comes like as everything fails, like they installed basically isolation systems to minimize the fuel. And there's also basically relief system as our flares or PSVs, and then there's emergency response basically system. And incipient firefighting, incipient mean at least when fire starts, the emergency escape routes of the plant should be available and people should be able to get away from the facilities in a reasonable time, so as a lesser life loss is there. So then there's a comparison between active and passive fire protection. Active fire protection, we have discussed earlier also, it is like a firefighting system, a foam system, then there are dry chemicals, there are like sprinkler systems, and similarly, various like mechanism, if I say one by one here, firefight, water pumps, detection and alarms, gas sensor, sensing detectors, sprinklers, water spray systems, water mist systems, foam system, foam water diluent system, and water spray system. Then clean agents are there, carbon dioxide systems are there, dry chemicals are there, steam snuffing is there, portable fire suppression system is there, hydrant and monitors are there, emergency isolation valve and ESD systems are there. So these are the part of the basically active fire protection system. And when we go to the Passive one is the next slide. So in passive fire protection system is a fireproofing, spill containment and drainage, diking, firewalls, electric area classification, static electricity and lightning protection system, or stray current protection system, physical separation of units and buildings. So these are the activities which comes under passive fire protection. If you see, active fire protection is a firefighting system, and passive fire protection is the actions what we arrange or we in place so as there is a lesser impact of fire, or if the fire should not be able to initiate at all. So then, in the firefighting system point of view, there could be a two type of firefighting systems. One could be automated, and another could be a manual one. Automated means, let's say at the plant, there are fire and gas detection system installed. And when say fire and gas detection system mean, if there is a heat, there is a smoke, or there is a hydrocarbon leakage, so these detectors should be able to detect the gas, and then the automated ESD system could be started, which leads to opening of all blowdown valves and closing of all ESD valves, and the plant go on shutdown. And in that scenario, the fire risk or its associated damages could be minimized. However, when there is automated system, sometime there is a false alarm, or sometime there is a false activation of the system. So in that scenario, there could be interruption in the facility process, and it may cause a loss of production, and there could be a false issue, but the automated system took the action. But automated action can prevent many incidents. There is a positive side, and human intervention is minimum. Whereas manual activation is when you see basically a fire or a hydrocarbon leakage or detection system, then the subsequent action is initiated by the operators or the operating staff. And in that scenario, there could be a certain delay, or there could be some time. There are incidents where operators could not take right decision, and the small fire changed into big fire, and there was bigger loss. However, both systems are available, and there are pros and cons of both systems, whether automated or manual one, and both systems are widely being used in the industry. If I say isolation is, for example, when a hydrocarbon incoming line or is coming from upstream from a well, or it's coming from other plant. So in case, if there's abnormality or gas leakage or there's a small fire, so you should be able to isolate the facility incoming basically hydrocarbon. And that isolation can be done by ESD valves, by manual valves, or by motorized valves. So there are various kind of valves, types of valves are available, and those are recommended. And normally, they are also called as a part of ESD system, right? And when we say type of valve, mean there's glow valve, ball valve, or the types of valves as well, which I said earlier also, ESD valves or motorized valves or manual valves. And these valves are normally installed at the boundary of the plant. Depressurization. Depressurization means that in case there's a high pressure in the system or there's a fire outside, and if you want to release the inventory of the system to atmosphere or through flare system, so that's called depressurization or blowdown. And all plants nowadays is a compulsory ASME requirement. Like there should be PSV on each pressure vessel or pressurized system. So as in case pressure goes out of range due to any reason, so fluid should be able to go or could be released rapidly to the atmosphere of the flare system. So this is one of the main requirement of the design. So if depressurization can take place in a timely manner, then it can reduce the risk of the damage to the facilities. Similarly, we saw firefighting system as a manual versus automated. Similarly, isolation is also there as a manual valve versus automated valve, like ESD could be controlled with the press of ESD buttons. Similarly, depressurization can also take place by three mechanisms. One is like by blowdown valves, which can be operated through ESD system. Number two, PSVs, which are operated by the set point based springs, and it can release the pressure in case of high pressure. And third could be the manual valves, when basically any operator can operate those valves. Emergency response. See, emergency response is seen in different ways. You can just see an example. For example, if a hydrocarbon gas or natural gas is being distributed in a living facility or living area or in a city, if that leakage occurs in that particular pipeline, then there could be a call out. Other people may call the civil defense, or they can make call to the gas distribution company. And in that scenario, there would be response from various authorities. The gas supplying company would basically activate their people. They may try to stop the gas in the area, and they will isolate it. And similarly, civil defense will mobilize firefighting equipment of the city, so as if there's any fire, they can fight it. And similarly, they will also involve health authorities or district management or police, so as the risk to the people or the environment could be minimized, and the life of the people could be saved in a reasonable time. So if you see, emergency response has a significant influence on a company fire protection strategy. The question is to fight or not to fight fire at a facility. Emergency response is one of the last layer of protection available to the facility. Then you run away. If in a refinery point of view, if there's a fire in a tank farm, they will try to fight the fire for the first 1 hour or two, and then they will also try to depressurize, or they would also try to remove the inventory from the tank. But if things goes out of control, then they have to evacuate the area, because normally tank farm fire affect up to 2 kilometer area, because there's a boil over scenario. So in that scenario, the refinery management try to take emergency response to get away from the fire area. So this is the last layer of protection which normally works, or which is normally in place in case there are emergencies. And there are other way also there, like each companies, whether it is Saudi Aramco or ADNOC or QP, they have a proper emergency response plans, and they also have emergency response plan control room. In case of any emergency, how they will be channelizing, or they will be organizing the actions for the first thing as a firefighting activity, number two as a rescue efforts, and number three as a rehabilitation program as well. So it's a normal part of any emergency management action. Like, there should be emergency response team and leadership, and there are basically drills and exercises which are done and to ensure that the emergency response team is in place, and they would be able to take the proper actions as and when required. Like, last point here, external response may include local fire departments or mutual aid organization. So this example I gave in the beginning, when there's a fire in a gas network in the city. So in that scenario, you need involvement of all the governmental bodies to ensure that the mutual action is taken in a given time. Active fire protection systems. There are various active fire protection systems, as we mentioned earlier, firefighting system, or when we say firefighting systems, you mean water sprinkler system, water deluge system, and water-based foam system. And then there is a dry chemicals, or there are FM200 or CO2-based systems. So there are various kind of firefighting systems available. And the first one, if we try to see a water-based system, so first question comes, how much water is required for any given fire? So if we try to, we'll cover through the example also when you will see the case study. So I'm just giving you the outline. The water demands basically is calculated based on the area which would be covered by that firefighting system or water ring main. And in that scenario, like if, let's say, there's a tank farm, there's a process plant as a refinery, and there's a jetty, and the loading, basically arm for the tanks and the utility areas. So in that scenario, when we are estimating the water demand or water amount involved, required to fight the fire, so the estimation is done for the required water for the each area separately, and then worst fire is considered, generally it is a tank farm area, and then we say, okay, this much total water is required, and for the worst area, and the facilities are built as per the worst area fire requirement. It is not considered like the fire would be everywhere. It is considered that fire would be in any one given area. Double or triple Zeffirelli concept is not applied for the calculation of fire water demands. However, the worst fire is considered, and then the that water is basically supplied through the fire water pumps. So like water demands for one area within a plant may include, say, utility area, loading racks, office buildings, then others, but the concept is same. This could be, it may not be utility area which would be leading the basically the water demand. That could be generally a tank farm area. So once you know the water demand, then as per the NFPA requirement, we have to arrange basically water pumps, one diesel, one motor, or there could be one jockey pump to maintain the pressure in the ring main, and then water point of view, whether water is a sweet water, water is a sea water, depending upon the availability of the resources of the water, the system is built, and there could be a dry system, there could be a wet system in the like depending on the spray system or sprinkler system or dealer system. However, the water arrangement is made in accordance with NFPA 15 and 13 requirement, and then pumps are maintained in accordance with NFPA, I think 20, and these are the standards we need to follow. The liability of fire water supply should be such that loss of any one source does not result in a loss of more than 50% of the flow requirement of the water system. So water distribution, like the water distribution means like how the water would be reached to the various locations. If you see sometime in the living areas in the city, we see fire hydrants here and there, and there is a water ring main below those hydrants, and you can see this is this kind of hydrants or this kind. And so in this basically attached water hydrant, there's a water ring main underground, and this is linked with the water, so basically a pumping system. So, and this is called water mains. And there are valves and fittings which are basically applied to isolate or to regulate the water flow as and when required. And fire hydrant and monitors, which are required to throw the water or to basically link with the basically firefighting trucks, also they need to take water and they need to further take actions. So that arrangement is also managed by fire hydrants and monitors. So fire water pumps, like fire water pumps, like once we know the water capacity and the water systems are installed, then fire water pumps are installed as part of the design. Fire water pumping capacity, flow rate should be sufficient to provide the required amount of water at required pressure to the fire areas having the greatest demand. At least 50% of the pumping capacity should be from diesel driven pumps. Fire water pumps should have a minimum capacity of, let's say, 1500 GPM, and can range from 5000 GPM up to 5000 GPM as well. It is common practice to provide pumping capacity so that when the largest fire water pump is out of service, the total fire demand can still be met. Each pump should be subject to a full capacity test or checking upon installation. And this is as per NFPA 20 requirements. Detection and alarm. Like nowadays, like all of us are aware, like there are, because media is there and there are high rise buildings are there, and we hear basically fires, alarms, and then fire trucks are moving here and there. So issues are there, we know, and there are regulatory requirements by the municipalities and the other regulators, like where we need to install fire, heat, smoke detectors inside the buildings, inside the plants, and basically these detection and alarms, there are various aspects. Like one is like how to detect fire in a particular area. So there's a fire zoning, like plant or facilities are divided into various fire zones. They are named as per their fire zones, and then combination of various kind of detectors, like heat detector, smoke detector, a gas detector, a hydrocarbon gas detector, or toxic gas detectors. Those are installed in various basically fire zones. And there is a fire basically voting system. Like if there's to distinguish between a real fire and a false alarm, so as more than one detector is basically installed in those areas, so as the voting system or proper confidence could be ensured if a message is being given by the fire and gas detection system. So it should not be a false information, because sometimes if there's only one detector in each area, if that detector is giving false alarm, and then the reliability of the system will go away. So the number of factors which must be considered in the design of a reliable fire detection and alarm system includes data on the nature and arrangement of power source, the coverage provided by the system, alarm function on loss of system operability, suitability of detection system, devices for the risk involved, or kind of basically detection they wish to do, testing and maintenance procedures to ensure a reliable system, consequence associated with the false alarms. For example, if the false alarm would be there, then what kind of, like if the evacuation is being done based on the false alarm in a high-rise building, every time people would be walking out. Or similarly, if there would be a real threat, then people will not be able to distinguish whether it is a real threat or it was a false alarm. So those aspects are real to need to be managed properly. See, water sprinkler system, if people who are used to go nowadays to malls and there's basically parking lots, you will see various detectors and sprinklers installed in all those basically parking bays and over the cars. And similarly, in a building where we are sitting, not here, but yes, there's also one detector and one basically fire sprinkler is there, and which is linked with a water supply system. And these waters, these sprinklers are required or meant to spray water in case there's a abnormal situation or there's a smoke. And this is a requirement of the municipality. Though sometimes it may cause trouble for the laptops if the false water spray come through. But this is the requirement of NFPA, I think 13, and the system should be installed and as per the local regulatory authority or civil defense system. Sprinklers are the Sprinklers are the most common fire protection system used today. The success of fixed water suppression system depends on the following: adequate and reliable water supply, adequate water density, automated actuation of the system, effective water spray patterns, alarm that indicate the operation or malfunction of the system, effective maintenance and testing. So in sprinkler systems, like there could be a wet pipe system, there could be a dry pipe system, and there could be like an overall deluge system. And there could be action can also be defined into two, pre-action and post-action. Wet pipe means there is a water available or foam available up to the last point, and a dry pipe means water is available up to deluge valve. And once we activate the system, then water would reach to the final destination. There are pros and cons of the both system. In wet system, there is more inspection maintenance activities required, and in dry system, there could be basically less corrosion, but sometimes there could be a time delay. Or sometime there may not be like water may not be reaching the last destination when water is required to be reaching. Deluge system is an overall combination of the system like how the system is linked with the main water supply supply system, and then sprinkler or the spray systems, and it is basically a combination of a wet or dry system, and both are working in combination of NFPA 13 and 15. So water spray system or water sprinkler system are very close to each other, right? And NFPA 13 and NFPA 15, they work hands in hand. A water spray system is hydraulically designed with open spray heads to protect a specific hazard. The term water spray refers to the use of water discharge from the nozzles having a predetermined pattern, droplet size, velocity, and density. And while delivery system are for the overall protection of the given area, water spray system can be installed for the protection of a given area or a specific equipment or hazard. Water spray systems are used for protection against hazards involving gaseous and liquid flammable materials and combustible solid materials. The design of water spray system should be in accordance with NFPA 15. Water mist system. Like this system, normally if there is a specific requirement or we may not throw water more than a specific quantity, then it's a special design by the some companies, and these are the mists where the more foam is made by the water, but the less water quantity is being used. A water mist system is a proprietary fire protection system using very fine water sprays. The very small water droplets allow the water mist to control or extinguish fire by cooling of the flame and fire plumes. Oxygen displacement by water vapor and radiant heat attenuation is the main objective of water mist system. The water mist system are intended for rapid suppression of fires using water discharge into completely enclosed limited spaces. Potential application include flammable and combustible liquids, electrical hazards. Normally water is not allowed. So these are the mists which could be used in specific conditions such as transformers and switches. Then circuit breakers and rotating equipments as well. Then electronic equipment. See, water is not allowed. Maybe in specific conditions, a mist can be used. It's a very, very special design and a very, very important cautions to be taken before this system is in place, because water is not a recommended firefighting system for electrical installations. Dry gases or FM-200 is a main source of firefighting for electrical systems. Foam system is a very common system for hydrocarbon fires, especially for the tanks. And here, the normal phenomenon of a foam is there's a chemical substrate and that is mixed with water, foam is made, and then foam is thrown over the area for a 10 minutes time. And there are various kind of substrate material which are used for foam making. There could be a low expansion foam, there could be a medium expansion foams, and there will be high expansion foams, like a foam up to 20 times, 20 to 200 times, and 200 times to 1,000 times. Foam system have more components requiring high maintenance and they have a somewhat lower reliability than water only system. But foam is required, for example, for a floating roofs, for the rim seals, foam is a more important to be used. And similarly, in many areas where water may not be effective, the foam is the only effective mechanism which should be used. And in a hydrocarbon industry or petrochemical industry, you will see as a foam system as a one of a permanent firefighting system in line along with water systems. And NFPA 11 is the guideline or standard which describe the requirement of foam system. Like there are various mechanisms like a foam application method. There will be fixed system, semi-fixed system, or portable system. Portable system means like if I start from the last, like you can carry a truck which can throw foam in case of any emergency. Semi-fixed system is some part of the system is installed, like the final foam pourers and some piping network is installed, but truck will be required to be installed or to be linked with that basically foam distribution system, and then the foam would be thrown in case of any emergency. Fixed system, normally we see in the tank farms where every aspect of the system is installed and foam can be made and can be thrown in case of any emergency. Like proportion, like how the foam is made, like there are two or three mechanisms. One is like when substrate is taken from a container of a substrate and then it is pushed through the water, and other part is there is a vent reaction and water is passing with a high speed, high velocity in a pipe, and then can also suck the substrate from the chemical container and it can prepare the foam basically. Right. Now, foam applications, like point of view, how many foam pourer would be there? Yes. How many like a foam? How many foam pourers are required? You can see this picture here, where foam chamber is there and is throwing the foam over the surface and the fuel. And here, like if the diameter of a tank is, let's say, up to 24 meter or 80 feet, one basically pourer is enough. And if the diameter is 24 to 36, then two pourers, and if 36 to 42, three pourers, and let's say last one is 54 to 60 meter, five pourers are required. And like these are thumb rules, but normal surface area can also be calculated, and we can install the number of pourers. But the minimum number is as indicated in this slide. Foam water delivery system, like. Just like this is a system which is normally installed in the tank farms or in any hydrocarbon installation, where the water system is supplied as a normal like water hydrants, and basically and the like a valve system, like a delage valve. When this water, then there's a requirement of a foam, the delage system is activated, and this water is mixing with the substrate in the chemical containers, and then the foam system is thrown as a one system. Just like a water delage system, there's a water foam delage system. The foam water sprinkler system is basically the same as sprinkler system, except foam concentrate is proportioned into the water, causing foam to be discharged. These systems can flow either water or foam effectively. The foam system should be designed in accordance with NFPA 16. The foam discharge rate for a foam sprinkler system should be at least 0.16 GPM per feet square. This is a density basically. The pattern, the foam discharge should be continuous for minimum time of 10 minutes. With the exception of high expansion foams, all other basically foams can be used in a foam water sprinkler system. However, AFF is the most like a versatile agent because of its spreading capability, and it can be applied through ordinary sprinkler heads. Clean agents. Clean agents like I think FM200 is used for like control rooms or substations, and and it can be basically installed, it should be installed for areas where water is not allowed. Clean agents are electrically non-conductive, conductive, volatile, or gaseous fixed extinguishing agents that do not leave a residue. Clean agents fall within two categories, hydrocarbons and inert gases. The typical hydrocarbons include hydrofluorocarbons and hydrofluorocarbons and perfluorocarbons as well, and the name is becoming more longer. Typical inert gases include argon, nitrogen, carbon dioxide, or combinations of these agents. Clean agents can be used to protect enclosures containing electrical and electronic equipment, subfloors, and other concealed spaces, flammable and combustible liquids, telecommunication equipment. And design of clean agents fire protection system should follow NFPA 2001. Carbon dioxide is also a similar kind of system which could be used in the areas where like water is not allowed. Like a carbon dioxide system should be designed and installed and tested in accordance with NFPA 12, fixed CO2 system, maybe total flooding or local application system. Total flooding means this type of system may be used where there is a permanent enclosure around the area or equipment to be protected that is adequate to enable the required concentration to be built up and to be maintained for the required period of time to ensure complete and permanent fire extinguishment. Local applicable area system, this type of system may be used for the extinguishment of surface fires, inflammable liquid, gases, and solids where the hazard is not enclosed. Example of hazard that may be successfully protected by local application system include dip tanks, quench tanks, and spray booths. Dry chemicals are the normal, like these chemicals can be used anywhere, and you see many baskets with sand and basket with chemical or basket or chemical in the fire extinguishers as well. Dry chemicals are recognized for their unusual efficiency in extinguishing two-dimensional fire involving flammable liquids. Fast actions is achieved provided the agent engulf the fire without interruption of the application. These agents are effective on small spill fires if there is a risk of reignition from basically embers or hot surfaces. These ignition surfaces should be quenched or cooled with water or to be secured from the foam, or the source of fuel should be shut off before attempting extinguishment. Dry chemical agents are non-toxic and are suitable for extinguishing clothing fires or on the individual people as well. Portable fires, basically suppressing equipment, we all are familiar. There are many type of fire extinguishers we see in our daily life. And if you see example of portable equipment include fire extinguishers are there, fire water monitors are there, foam monitors are there, foam adapters are there, foam tanks are there, water tanks, special high flow nozzles, trailer mounted fire water pumps, and water foam pumpers, and aerial and radar fire trucks are also used. We call them portable fire suppressing equipment. But fire extinguishers are more common, what we see all around. Fire water monitors, we also see in the buildings. Foam monitors, we also see in the industry. So these are the various types to get familiar with the terminologies. Now we basically covered basic theories or basic concept behind the firefighting engineering or fire suppression system or fire prevention systems. Now we will go through your questions, and the next 10 to 15 minutes we'll try to answer your questions. And then my colleague, Frasad, will start the basic engineering, like a case study will be presenting what we have done, actual design of firefighting or fire and gas detection system designs.
Yeah. Okay, now we received quite a few questions with regards to the topic. And we received a question, just read out the questions. It's, oil and gas industry, normally what type of firefighting agent shall be used? In oil and gas industries, normally what type of firefighting agent shall be used? Please explain.
See, in oil and gas industry, the firefighting systems which I mentioned, number one, water-based systems, foam-based systems, then clean agents, then CO2 system, dry chemicals. So all the basically the firefighting equipment and system we mentioned today, the mainly they work around basically oil and gas industry. They're all oil and gas industry. Like when we say clean agents, like FM200, a CO2 system, or a foam system, or water separator system, or water spray system, fire water hydrant system, these all are for the oil and gas system. Next question.
Yeah. The next question would be, why foam isn't applicable to LPG fire?
See, for LPG fires, you don't see normally foam. You will see water systems because LPG is lighter. Like when it comes to fire, it's making less basically pool fires. Where there's a pool fire, you try to prefer to use foam. If chance of pool fire is lesser, then we don't prefer to use foam there. Other type of foam systems are used.
Okay, the next question would be, CO2 type fire extinguishing system is now used only in places where unmanned facilities are there. Does it have any effect on the ozone depletion, or is it just a toxic chemical to human beings?
No, it's both. It's both. Like clean agents are the preferred one, and the CO2 use is being reduced. Clean agent or CO2, both are used in the control rooms and substations, and in the areas where human beings should be evacuated before these gases are injected. Before these gases are basically, or CO2 is injected or clean gas is injected, the human being should not be there. Next question.
One of the participants have asked, are we going to get this study material for?
Yes, we will be basically putting this presentation on the YouTube channel of Velocity. You'll get it. Any question? Go through your questions, please.
Is active fire protection system can be termed as a firefighting system, and passive can be termed as fire protection one?
No. See, fire protection and fire protection and fire prevention are basically working side by side, and those are the areas which works with the designing of the system. Like, excuse me, please.
You have to be silent. You are standing in front of me.
Okay. You should oversight. It's better. Sorry, there was some interruption. See, passive fire protection and active fire protection are two different issues. The active fire protection, where we are basically talking about the firefighting system itself, like water system, foam system, clean agent system, fire extinguishers, those all are the active firefighting. And the passive fire protection is just like fireproofing, hazard area classification, and so on. But when we say fire prevention and fire protection, there is a little bit basically confusion in both two areas, in my view. So I would not say like fireproofing is a part of fire prevention, right? The little definition difference is there, and I'm not so clear about that particular point, so I will not answer now. Next question.
Is there any emergency report made after fire or an incident happens?
Yes, there are always incident reports. Yes, incident reports are there. There are investigations, and these things are taken very seriously in the oil and gas industry.
Okay. Why pool fire is called two-dimensional fire and running liquid fire as 3D fire?
See, pool fire, like if there's a pool, for example, there's a hydrocarbon on the floor or in the dike, so it would be two-dimensional. Running pipe, for example, or a channel, right? In that scenario, there would be three-dimensional.
We have a question. What is ESD system?
ESD system is emergency shutdown system for the plant. Like in case there's emergency in the plant, by push of the button, all like drivers will shut down, all power supply will cut off. So as plant go to safe shutdown mode.
How fire demand could be estimated in addition to provided values in literature?
See, actual engineering is there. And when you have a facilities, plants, so we need to like calculate the surface area of the plant where, first of all, the plant we don't consider as a one part. There are various zones and parts of the facility. In a process plant as well, unit one, unit two, unit three, unit four, and there are utility area, there's tank pump area, there is a jetty, there's loading areas. So the each area is basically separately divided into sub areas, and then it's like considered in which area fire could be at one given place, and then how much firefighting agents would be required. And then accordingly, their quantities are estimated.
What is fire protection requirement for existing installed scraper, launcher, or receiver?
See, whether there's a bigger launcher or a receiver or a separator, or there could be various kind equipment in the upstream facility or a downstream facility. So surface area is calculated, like and there's a water separate density requirements for the dealer system. And if foam is required, foam is also calculated accordingly. So there's a diameter and length of the scraper, and the surface area is calculated accordingly. And then water separate densities or foam separate densities are defined in the NFPA standard, and area multiplied by the separate density, you calculate the quantity, and then the supply system is installed. Okay, so now we start the next part, and then we'll have a question answer sessions once at the end also. Thank you. Mr. Frost.
Thank you, Mr. Ajaz. we have discussed the theoretical part of this fire protection engineering and design. And now we will discuss the practical aspects of the same. This section is basically based on the case study that we have conducted previously for our refinery. And please note that the client name and data have been redacted. So we will, following a practical approach, where we will walk you through the key aspects through all this case study. So this was the project background. The HSE gap assessment audit was conducted for the all upstream facilities of the client, and various recommendations were made to improve the following systems: fire and gas detection system, active firefighting system, passive firefighting system, HSEMS and associated control procedures. Velocity has carried out feed engineering and development of HSEMS related documentations in accordance with the requirements identified during the gap assessment studies. Briefly, the project objectives were feed engineering for the FNG detection system, design of active and passive fire protection systems, development of HSEMS related documentations in accordance with the requirements identified during the gap assessment studies. So there were several facilities. So for the facility A, the scope of work was to calculate the fire water demand and automatic gaseous flooding system for control room and electrical rooms, automatic sprinkler system for the living quarters, fire water curtain system at the escape routes, and to remove the existing detectors and install the new toxic gas detectors and flammable gas detectors, new instrumented automatic fire detection for process equipment for all the production platforms. So this was the scope of work for the facility A. This was for the facility B, that we have removed the existing detectors and installed the new toxic gas detectors and flammable gas detectors. Then remove the existing detection and design and install new fire detection system for building and process equipment with centralized control system. Then this was the scope of work for facility C, that bladder tank foam system in place of PPT system with 100% connected reserves, sprinkler system for dining hall at the camp A, C and lab, automatic gaseous flooding system for the main control room, and then for the replacement of the existing detectors with the new toxic gas detectors, and to remove the existing detection and design and install new fire detection system. And this was the scope of work of facility B for D. To calculate the additional requirements for the FM200 system at station control room, remove the existing detectors and install the new toxic gas detectors, and the same with the other facilities as well, to remove the existing detection and design and install new fire detection system. So this was the project execution methodology. These steps were used basically to execute this project. Project kickoff, then collection of data available in the client's head office, then site visits, surveys, then updating of the design basis memorandum, then FNG mapping study, then preparation of the basic engineering deliverables, then review and internal QN QC checks, then cost estimation, purchase requisition of long lead items, and EPC tender package. This is the graphical representation. Project starts with the project kickoff meeting, then site survey and collection of data, then submission of the site survey reports, then detailed study and checking of adequacy and integrity of the existing fire water system, then preparation and updation of the design basis memorandum, then performing the basic engineering study, FNG mapping and study for the selected area under this scope. So these were basic deliverables. Continue the other slide. Issuance of engineering deliverables, then submission of basic engineering dossier, then preparation of EPC tender package. It involves scope of work, cost estimation, project execution schedule, RFQ for long lead items. Then in the end, all the submission of all the final deliverables. So, these were the codes and standards used during the execution of this project. These were the major deliverables: fire water demand calculation report, design basis memorandum, basic engineering design data, project coordination procedure, document numbering procedure, document control register, site survey and document retrieval reports, project basic design dossier, EPC scope of work, cost estimates, EPC tender package. And project execution schedule, bill of materials or quantities, project HSE plan, long lead item list, long lead item RFQs, specification of material procurement, specification of test and commissioning, QA/QC procedures, site test specification, transportation vessel requirement. So all these were the major deliverables for this project. So now the sprinkler system design. So basically, the task was to design the sprinkler system at the living quarters. These are the gaps and recommendations for the living quarters according to the RFA report. So this study is based on the RFA report. At the living quarters, without sprinkler system, personal life is at risk, as chance of escape will be less, especially in offshore platforms, and potential loss of life will be high. The people's life is high risk as living quarters fall within the radius of 12.5 kW per meter square radiation control from production separator at CPF platform. Living quarters at CPF are to be protected with automatic sprinkler system. The automatic sprinkler system is to be designed as per NFPA 13. So these are basically the gaps and recommendations. So for the implementation of these recommendations, there were three levels of living quarters at CPF, Central Processing Facility, where the automatic sprinkler system is to be provided. One was main deck level, other was level one, and other third one was level two. So these were the some design criteria for the sprinkler system. According to NFPA 13, This NFPA 13 is mainly referred for carrying out the design of sprinkler system. Living quarters are considered ordinary hazard occupancies. Wet pipe sprinkler system is considered for living quarters. Flangible glass bulb type sprinkle nozzle having temperature rating range is selected on the basis of maximum ceiling temperature 38 degrees centigrade as per NFPA 13, table 6.2.5.1. The maximum allowable protection area of coverage for sprinkler is taken as 130 square feet as per NFPA 13, table 8.6.2.2.1b. And the maximum spacing between the sprinklers is taken as 15 feet, as per the NFPA 13. And the spacing between the sprinkler branch lines is taken 12 feet on the basis of maximum coverage area per sprinkler nozzle. The dimensions of each room at all three levels of living quarters are measured during the site survey and marked on the CPF layout, living quarters plans, living quarters side elevations. Then the layout drawings are developed as per the dimensions measured during the site survey. The elevation of the ceiling for all the rooms at the living quarters is 2.27 meters. As pendant type sprinklers are considered, so these would be installed at ceiling level. The elevation of the main deck from the Trident 7 level is taken as 3 feet. The design density of sprinkler system for main deck level, level 1 and level 2, living quarters, is taken on the basis of the calculated area as per NFPA 13. And 10% additional water demand is considered in calculation for hydraulic imbalances as per standard engineering practice. Fire hydrants are already available at living quarters, so no host stream is considered. It is to be checked and verified during the APC stage. Then the hydraulic calculations are performed by using PipeNet software. This was the version of the PipeNet software. Hydraulic calculations are carried out on the basis of Hazen-Williams equation as per NFPA 13. C factor used in the Hazen-Williams equation is taken as 120. These are basically assumptions for the calculations as per NFPA 13. Water viscosity and density are taken as 2.42 per foot hour. At 68 degree Fahrenheit for hydraulic calculations. Nominal K factor for pendant type nozzle is taken as 5.6 gallon per minute. PSI liter per, it can be, and half inch NPT is considered as per NFPA 13 for fire water sprinkler nozzle. So these are basically the design criteria for the sprinkler system. The maximum friction loss value is considered as 1.5 bar. The nominal allowable velocity limit for fire water sprinkler system is considered as 6 feet per second, 19.68 feet per second as per NFPA 20. And for living central process facility living quarters area, the existing fire water piping layout and PNID is not available. So fire water tie-in point for sprinkler system is not identified. However, we also understand that the tie-in connection for the sprinkler system can be taken from the discharge header of the fire water pumps. Fresh water is considered for fire water sprinkler system as fire water at CPF Trident 3 area is fresh water referred from RFA report. So these were basically the design criteria. Now this is the calculation for the main deck level. Basically the main deck level living quarters consist of men rooms. There were two men rooms as well as four men rooms, warehouse, sick bay, laundry and corridors where the automatic sprinkler system is to be provided. So first of all, it is for the main deck for the men rooms. So we will calculate for the individual rooms first. The calculation starts with the length of length and width, and then there is an area, length into width. And this is for the second room, same calculations. So the total number of two men, there were 10 rooms, and total number of four men rooms were two. So total number of sprinklers required for all the rooms is 1 into 12, because one is this, the coverage area per sprinkler as per NFPA 13 is 130 feet square. So number of sprinklers required for each room is 108.344 area divided by this coverage area. So we have approximately one. So we need one in each. So there were 12 rooms, 10 for the two men and two for the four men. So total 12 rooms. So this will be the total area for all the rooms. So similar calculations for the warehouse, length into width, we have an area, then the coverage area per sprinkler as per NFPA 13 is 130 feet square. So area divided by this coverage area, we got one, and this is for the sick bay, similar calculations, length into width, we have an area, then the 130 square feet is the coverage area per sprinkler as per NFPA 13. So the calculation is 2. So number of sprinklers required for the sick bay is 2. And for the laundry, same, this was the area of the laundry. And in the end, the number of sprinklers required for the laundry is 2. For the main corridors, same calculations, the length, the width, we have the area, then the sprinkles for the basically there is a change in the requirement for the corridors. It should be 15 feet. So we need 6 sprinklers in the main corridor. So these were the overall main deck calculations. Total number of sprinklers required were 23. Total area of all these main areas, the main decks, and this laundry area is 2085.45 feet square. The design density as per NFPA 13 is this. The fire water demand we can calculate by multiplying this design density with the total area. We will have the fire water demand. So fire water demand with 10% hydraulic balance, it's 435.86 gallon per minute. So this is basically the PipeNet software which we have used for these calculations. For sizing the sprinkler system network at main deck level living quarters, line sizing is performed by verifying maximum allowable velocity is not exceeded at any point in the network system. For finding out the required pressure at each sprinkler nozzle and at inlet of sprinkler system, so that each sprinkler nozzle pressure is maintained at minimum of 0.48 bar gauge or 7 PSIG pressure. So these were the input data which we have used in the software, PipeNet software. The input nodes, the output nodes, ties, diameters, length, elevation, C factors. And these were the results of the hydraulic calculation of the main deck level sprinkler system. These are the inputs, output nodes, input pressures, output pressures, friction losses, velocity, flow rates, US gallon per minute. For all these data which we have put, and this, these were the sprinkler nozzles results of hydraulic calculations of main deck level sprinkler system. These are, this is the basically layout where these sprinklers are required. So this is the conclusion. For the installation of fire water sprinkler system at a central processing facility living quarters, Refer below for hydraulic calculations, fire water demand, and its tie-in point pressure for all three levels of living quarters. So, for main deck, for level 1, for level 2, fire water flow rate required at the main deck is 495 gallon per minute. For level 1 and level 2, 565 and 510 GPM. And this is the pressure, the tie-in point pressure, the required. So, we have discussed the calculation for the main deck in the previous slides. For the level 1 and level 2, we have done in the similar manner. Now, the gaseous flooding system design. This is basically the graphical representation of automatic activation of FM200. Before going to the gaseous flooding system design, to a quick view review of this system, how it works. It is basically a server room. Detector zone 1 and detector zone 2. These are the cylinders. At zone 1, the detector system is activated because of fire. It gives a signal to the existing control panel, then the alarm bell activated. Then the second zone detector activated. Then the pre-discharge alarm. Then it will shut down all the air condition and the ventilation systems to cut off the oxygen supply. Then there will be a 60 second countdown. Maybe it can be a false alarm or so. It can be aborted if it is a false by manual system. If not, then after 60 seconds, so FM200 is discharged and extinguish the fire. So this was the basic representation of this gaseous flooding system. As per this FRA report, the scope of work for the automatic gaseous flooding system in the main control room building was: the basic engineering for the installation of the automatic total flooding gaseous extinguishing system for main control room, including powerhouse control room and UPS room at main control building, offices and meeting rooms are not included in the scope of work. So this was the design criteria for this gaseous flooding system. The main control room, including powerhouse control room and UPS room, are considered for the design of total flooding gaseous suppression system. 50 bar gauge Novik 1230 clean agent is considered as per decision by the company. Novik 1230 system design is as per NFPA 2001. Design concentration of Novik 1230 at room temperature of 21 degrees C is taken as 4.725% as per the recommendation by the vendor according to NFPA 2001. The flooding factor is referred as this as per recommendation by the vendor according to the NFPA 2001. And the dimensions of the MCR building are referred from the existing layout drawings, from the dimensions also providing site surveys, central banking systems, and 100% connected standby clean agent filled cylinder system is considered. So these were the calculations for the requirement to calculate the required quantity of Novik 1230 clean agent. Novik 1230 is like FM 200 with some differences, but it was because of the client recommendation, so we use this Novik 1230 as per the scope. So the total area for the main control room was 198.81 meter square. Room height was this. Ceiling void height was 0.41 meters, and floor void height was 0.25 meter. These measurements were taken during the site survey. So the room volume will be this, the ceiling volume will be this, and total volume of the total volume of the main control room and powerhouse control room is 668 cubic meter. So the minimum requirement for the Novik 1230 was total volume into the flooding factor. Flooding factor is 0.6873 kilogram per cubic meter multiplied by the total volume of the main control room and powerhouse control room. We have 460 kg is the minimum requirement for the Novik 1230 agent, cleaning agent. And for the this calculation follows a similar pattern, and this is for the UPS room. The total area for the UPS room was 60.47 meter square. And these are the room height, the ceiling void heights, and the floor void height. Then the room volume, the ceiling void volume, the floor void volume. Then the total volume is 203.2 cubic meter. Similarly, the flooding factor, which was 0.6873 kilogram per cubic meter multiplied by the total volume of the UPS room, we have the minimum requirement for the Novik 1230 was 140 kg. This was the layout. This is the generic layout. So, as central banking and selected directional valve concept is considered, so the design Novik 1230 capacity of the system is on the basis of highest in the demand room. The clean agent Novik 1230 demand for the main control room is the highest. So its clean agent demand will be the governing scenario. So quantity of Novik 1230 clean agent required is 460 kg. One cylinder quantity is 92 kg. So how many cylinders we need? So the main cylinder bank requirement is 5 cylinders, and for the reserves also 5 cylinders. So now the foam system design. So basically this was the recommendation of the FRA report, and the gap. And the following modifications are considered in the existing room system at the tank farm area. To install 100% connected reserve system to have extended fire protection, at the same time to replenish the foam concentrate in the main system, as well as to check the adequacy of the existing foam system piping diameters, and to upgrade the existing pressure proportioning system to bladder tank foam proportioning system, as bladder tank system is stores the foam in the bladder and does not allow water to mix with foam. In bladder tank, foam is stored within the bladder and there is no contact with water inside the tank. When seawater mixes with the foam, concentrate and impurities in seawater such as shells, marine growths, algae might mix with foam concentrate. The system can get blocked and will not be available while needed. So the existing foam chambers do not match with NFPA 11 requirements. These are to be designed as per the NFPA 11. These are basically the gaps and the recommendations of the report. We'll let the calculation of this foam system. So this was the design criteria for the foam system, that total foam generator stations are 4. Existing foam storage tanks are PPT. existing 4 PPT foam storage tanks will be replaced with bladder type foam storage tanks with 100% reserves. Total oil tanks to be protected are 14. 8 were floating roofs and 6 were fixed roof. NFPA 11 is mainly referred for the carrying out these calculations, and 3% fluoroprotein foam solution is considered as per existing system and FRA report. These are the further design criteria that full surface fire protection is considered as per NFPA 11 and rim seal fire protection is considered for floating roof type as per NFPA 11. Application rate for fixed roof storage tank is considered as 4.1 LPM per cubic per meter square. Application time for fixed roof crude oil tank is considered 55 minutes and for fixed roof diesel oil tank is 30 minutes. And the application time for floating roof tank is considered as 20 minutes. The number of hose streams for each tank, minimum operating time of 10, 20 or 30 minutes and discharge date of 189 liter per minute based on the simultaneous operation of the required minimum number of hose streams in referred from NFPA 11. Foam demand for initial piping filling of the particular tank is calculated from length and diameter of the piping for that particular tank. This was also the design criteria as per the NFPA 11. Number of foam chambers calculated on the basis of NFPA 11 for the floating roof tanks and NFPA 11 for the fixed roof tanks. These were the table, the specific tables, table 5.3, 5.3.1 for the floating roof and table 5.2, 5.2.1 for the fixed roof tanks. So basically there were two foam generator stations installed in tanks farm area for the fire protection of 4 oil storage tanks. By foam generator station 1, total number of oil storage tanks to be protected are 2. One is floating roof and one is fixed tank roof tank. So we will discuss the calculation in this slide. The service of this storage tank is bad crude oil. The type of this, it is a flammable liquid. Type of the roof is floating type. Rim seal fire protection is required. Fire will be extinguished using foam solution by creating a foam dam of width 0.6 meter at the floating roof. So these are the calculations. This is the diameter of the tank. This is the radius of the tank. This is the radius of the tank without the radius of the dam. This is the height of the tank. This is the foam dam area, 56.3 meter square. Foam solution flow rate for the tank is this. So foam solution demand will be in the foam solution flow rate multiplied by time, it will be 13740 liters. So foam concentration demand for tank A into 3% is 412.21 liters. The foam concentrate for hose stream is 2 numbers of hose are required. So it is 340.2 liters. And the foam concentrate for piping filling is 61.1 liters. So that, and the total foam demand will be 412.21 plus this 340, which was the foam concentrate for the hose stream, plus the foam concentrate for the piping fillings. So the sum of this foam concentrate demand for tank A plus foam concentrate for the hose stream plus foam concentrate for the piping filling will be the total foam demand, which is 813.5 liters. This is for the tank B. It is the pump run crude oil. It is also the flammable liquid, and the roof, the type of the roof is fixed roof. Previously it was the floating type, now it is fixed. Full surface fire protection is required. So this is the calculation: diameter of the tank, height of the tank, then the surface area, then the foam solution flow rate for tank B. So it is 0.1.88 LPM. So now the foam solution demand, similarly the calculations for the tank A, it is now for the tank B, the foam solution demand for tank B plus foam concentrate demand for tank B, this 333.11 liters, and this foam concentrate for the hose stream plus piping filling, it is 400.5 liters. So by a foam generator station number 2, total number of oil storage tanks to be protected is 1, which is floating roof tank. So below is the detailed description of oil tank to be fire protected by the foam generator station number 2. So similar calculations for the tank C. So basically, the bladder tank main and reserve capacities, according to the above calculations, following will be the foam bladder tank capacities. Foam generator station 1, the main foam generator station 1 bladder tank is 900 liters, and then the 100% reserve for the same 900 liters, and for the foam generator station number 2, for the main foam generator station 2 bladder tank requirement is 1800 liters, and the for the reserve same 1800 liters. So this is the foam chambers calculations. Number of foam chambers for tanks are calculated on the basis of NFPA 11 table this, and for the floating roof table 5.2 5.2.1 for the fixed roof tanks. The foam chambers to be equally spaced along with the circumference of the oil tanks. Below are the calculations foam chambers for all the tanks. For storage tank A, floating roof, diameter of the tank, circumference of the tank, spacing between each chamber 22.4 meters, minimum foam chambers required are 95.8 into 24.4, approximately 4 chambers are required. And for storage tank B, the diameter of the tank, the minimum foam chamber is required is 1. For the C, diameter, circumference, spacing between each chambers, then the minimum foam required chambers are 10. So this was the result summary. The foam generator station capacity, foam generator station 1, generator station 2, 900 liters, 1800 liters. The existing foam chambers for oil storage tank as per NFPA 11 for storage tank A, it was okay, because the existing number of foam chambers are more than the minimum required as per the NFPA. So what same for the tank B and same for the tank C. Now the fire water demand calculation. This was basically the purpose of the case study, the capacity to calculate, to determine the capacity of the fire water pump requirements, fire water storage tank capacity, foam proportional, and the storage tank capacities. These were the flow water requirements. The maximum fire water demand estimation is based on the assumption that only one major incident occurs at any time fire scenario likely to occur within the installation, NFPA 14. A 30% loss from the fire water design rate can be expected to occur due to wind and evaporation. Fire water storage of 8 hours duration has been considered. The fire scenarios considered for the projects are the storage area, the TAP area, the marine or port area, and the utilities and off area. UNO area. So these were the scenarios. Scenario 1 was the fire on the mixed naphtha storage tank. Scenario 2 was the fire on light naphtha export storage tank. Scenario 3 was fire on paraxylene export storage tank. And scenario 4 was fire on benzene export storage tank. Due to the limitation of time, we will discuss the scenario 1. Scenario 1 was the fire on mixed naphtha storage tank A. This was an external floating roof tank. Rim seal fire is considered as a credible scenario. Fire will be extinguished using the foam solution by creating foam dam of width 0.6 meter at the floating roof, tank A. Cooling adjacent storage tanks B, C. The exposed surface is the half perimeter of the shell in front of the flame radiation. So these were the calculations. This was the diameter of the tank. This is the height of the tank. This is the foam dam area. So the foam solution application rate for external floating roof tank as per the NFP 11 table B.1 is this. So the solution application rate will be foam dam area multiplied by this this application rate of 12.2. We have 1905.88 LPM or 114.35 cubic meter per hour. Considering 3% foam application, foam concentration required for the tank is 114.35, which was this over foam solution application rate, multiplied by this 3% foam application, we have 3.43 cubic meter per hour. And this is the foam application duration for the tank, which is 20 minutes. And foam concentration quantity for the tank will be this foam concentration requirement for the tank multiplied by this time, we have 1.14 cubic meter. So the water required for making the foam solution for the tank will be this multiplied by time and multiplied by 0.97. We have 36.97 cubic meter. This is for the dikes. Only oil spillage is considered in the dike area since it is not practical to cover a whole dike with foam. 4 into 450 liter per minute hose reel to be used on the spills for 30 minutes, which is largely above the minimum requirement as per code and standards. Foam required and the water. This shall be facilitated by the portable monitors. So this was the calculations. Exposed surface area of nearby tanks, considering 3.7 meter rundown for tank B and C, this will be the area. Application rate as per the for the adjacent tanks, as per the API 2030 section 7.2.1, it is 4.1 LPM per cubic per meter square. The water rate required for cooling the tanks is this area multiplied by this application rate. We have 767.78 cubic meter per hour. So these were the basic fire water requirement for the cooling purpose. 614.27 cubic meter. An additional fire water demand of 720 cubic meter per hour is considering simultaneous operation of 6 portable fire water foam monitors. Foam requirement for the portable monitors shall be 10.8 cubic meter for 30 minutes operation. So this was the summary for storage tank A. Water rate considering contingency, fire water demand, foam solution rate considering contingency and foam demand. So these were the calculation results. And this for the scenario two, same calculations. Similarly, like of tank A, the summary for tank B, and this the scenario C, which was the fire on paraxylene export storage tank. Similar calculations. This is the summary, and this is for the scenario 4, fire on benzene export storage tank J. Followed by the similar calculations, the summary. This is the result. In the aromatics plant area, the fire water demand of 4,000 cubic meter per hour is And we say for the tap area, for the marine and port area, the fire water demand of 720 cubic meter per hour is, and we say considering simultaneous operation of 6 fire water monitors. Then this is utility and offsite area, a fire water demand of 360 cubic meter per hour is, and we say considering simultaneous operation of 6 fire water hydrants. So this is basically the discussion. The largest fire water demand at the UNO facilities is 4,000 cubic meter per hour. The foam reserve or the foam AFF concentrate at 3% to be provided, considering 30% contingency as storage locations as follows. For the mixed naphtha storage tanks, it is 1.5 cubic meter of two tanks. Similarly, for the other storage tanks. For the usage of portable foam monitors, a foam reserve of 16 cubic meter of AFFF concentrate at 3% is to be kept in the facility. So it is the fire water pumps calculation. The 1022 cubic meter per hour capacity of the fire water pump is sufficient to meet the above fire water demand. The design of the pumps shall conform to NFPA 20 requirements. Therefore, the configuration of the fire water station will be as follows. 4 fire water pumps will be operated, 3 will be electric driven, and 1 will be the diesel one. Fire water pump capacity shall be 1022 cubic meter per hour. 1 fire water diesel pump will be standby. Fire water standby pump capacity shall be 1022 cubic meter per hour. And 2 jockey pumps with 60 cubic meter per hour of the capacity. So now the fire water storage tank. The fire water storage tank capacity should be 8 hours of the full flow demand of fire water pump discharge at 100% operation. Depending on the severity of the incident, in order to offer an overall 8 hours firefighting at full flow demand. 2 fire water storage tanks of 16,000 cubic meter minimum capacity shall be provided. So these were all based on the calculations. Now we have discussed the active fire protection. Now we will discuss the passive fire protection. This was another project. This was the brief project objective to conduct the passive fireproofing integrity management study for Fire Zone 14 as a pilot project of the onshore gas processing plant in client facility against the requirements of the latest edition of API 2218. The study was required to support the closeout of actions from an audit of the PFP at the plant. So this was the scope of work to undertake a gap analysis of passive fire protection requirements for an area, to review the fireproofing of the pipes ports for the sample of the area of plant based on the learning from the Valeriu Mäki incident, provide technical information and estimated cost for undertaking a gap analysis review of PFP for the balance areas, including the gap analysis and the condition assessment. So these were basically the project milestones, development of PFP integrity management framework, development of PFP operational performance standard, assessment of PFP requirements. This is specified protection requirements for one area. And then the site visit and fireproofing inspection to assess the condition of the PFP and identify any areas where either preventive fireproofing can be removed or additional PFP is required. So this was the project execution methodology. First of all, the gap analysis study has been carried out based on the visual inspection and the collection of relevant information from the client, guidelines provided in the client specifications and API 2218 are considered as the basis for the study. Each items in the plant, such as pipe racks, multi-level equipment structures, air cooler ports, pipe ports, fire potential equipment, ESDVs, cable trays, and long bolt bells were assessed as a part of the study. Based on the study, a PFP management framework strategy is prepared, which shall be used for the implementation of the gaps in other areas of plants as well. So these were basically the deliverables as the result of this PFP study, which were the PFP Integrity Management Framework Strategy, PFP Performance Standard, Anomaly Severity Levels, Gap Analysis Report, PFP Asset Register, PMIR for PFP, Cost Estimate for Balanced Areas. So these are some PFP for pipe sports in FSE, transfer line sports line in FSE, transfer lines with hangers in FSE. Equipment structure in the fire scenario in MALEP, the condensers, accumulators, heat exchangers for the reactors, and for the pipes. For the pipes, consider fireproofing all levels below fire potential equipment. For the heat exchanger, consider fireproofing regardless of the elevation above the grade. For the reactors, consider fireproofing reactor skirts, brackets or lugs. Consider fireproofing knees or diagonal bracing supporting vertical loads. So these are basically the structural supporting fire potential equipment in the fire scenario area. This is for the non-fire potential equipments and the fire potential equipments. This is for the structural supporting non-fire potential equipment in the fire scenario area. This is for the pipe rack without pumps in the fire scenario. This is with the pipe rack with large fire potential pumps installed below. And this is the air fin fan cooler in FSE. For this, no fireproofing on the stringer beams that do not support vertical loads. And for this, consider fireproofing stringer beams that support the vertical loads. So basically, there were some findings of this study, which were the steel structures supporting the fire potential equipment located within a fire scenario in MALEP shall be fireproof up to the highest level at which the equipment is supported. The fireproofing applied to skirt at all the fire potential equipments are found satisfactory and in compliance with the client project specification and API 2218. The pipe racks are made of precast concentrate elements, which itself is a fireproofing material, and extent of coverage is found satisfactory with no integrity anomaly identified. For the transfer line support, some of the pipe supports which are supporting loads from lines originating from fire hazardous equipment within a fire scenario enveloped from the equipment shall be fireproofed. For the pipe support, this was the finding that it needs to be PFP. And this is the structure under the air coolers. So this air cooler support legs on top of pipe rack, which are in fire scenario envelope, are not to be fireproofed in fire zone area 14 as per the client project specification and shall be fireproofed as per the client specification API 2218 section 5.1.2.2. All the members below the air cooler till grade shall be fireproofed. This is as per the API 2218. All existing PFP are meeting the requirements of the project specification. This is basically the conclusion of the study. As per API 2218 code, most of the items in fire zone 14 are sufficiently protected with passive fireproofing material, except air cooler supports and some pipe supports in close proximity to fire potential equipments. it was the conclusion of the study that the client specification shall be upgraded as per the latest requirement of API 2218 code. Inspection management plans shall be implemented for civil and structural assets for monitoring the PFP. And the cable trays are of fire retardant type, so no cable trays are fireproof as per API 2218 protection may be considered if trays with cable servicing neighboring units run through the fire scenario in weather. And the loss control review may indicate need of for fire protection as replacement of critical electrical feeder lines and rewiring cable trays after a fire can be very time consuming. Power and instrument cable can quickly be destroyed in a fire, impeding the ability to have a controlled shutdown. So these were the conclusions as a result of the PFP study for one of our clients. So now, if you have any questions.
So, yes. Yeah. So we'll be taking few questions that you have received.
We may not answer all the questions. There are many questions, but we'll select some and answer because the time is already over 4. So let's see. The energized computer more than 480 volts are to be considered under the which class? That is electrical equipment class. Which one is that class? And there's also one question with I think two slides are not matching the class K and F. What is the difference? Okay, so we go to next question. I've already finding the slide. Just bear with us. The next question is like this. There was a slide was different in slide 34. I think there's also a question, the same regarding the type of the fire. I think class K and F, that is difference. Yeah, type of the class. See here, class F. Yeah. And if you go previous slide, there's a class K.
Yeah, this one.
Class K. A, B, C, D, K. So which one is correct? We'll check. So I think the class F is more right. There's a typing error here. We'll check and correct the slide. And what other question was? Rating electrical. For electrical wire, there's a type is, for electrical is a class is what? Go to class.
Yeah, this one.
Previous slide. Electrical, which class? Very classification is there, yes. For electrical, live electrical class C. It does not matter what voltage, but class C is applicable. Right. Next question. We provide us the overview of the fire water demand calculation. I think we explained those demand calculation in the exercise, and the more details can be checked. There are examples given in NFPA 13 and NFPA 15 also. Examples are provided in those standards. So, one question answered. Why we cannot use CO2 for gases like CH4? CH4, any gas which is lighter than like molecular weight point of view, both equal volume equal molecular weight, so it is difficult to control that fire if the extinguishing gas is the same molecular weight. And the CO2 is used for the closed, basically rooms mostly. It cannot be used in the open, otherwise CO2 will evaporate. Same like CH4. Energy equipment more than 480 volts are to be considered under which class? Class C, we answered. Next question was, please provide us the overview of the water demand calculation. I mentioned example available in NFPA 13 and 15. And we have also given example in our presentation. Classification of fire in the previous slide was different, that we answered. Which agent is used for K class fire name, please? This is for the, basically for the kitchen equipment, and for kitchen, mostly dry chemicals are used. Next is wet chemical also classified as a clean agent, firefighting system like the FM2. FM2 is as a clean agent and is used for substations and control rooms. Then next question. What is steam snuffing system? See, steam or just like a water jet, in case of a fire, steam could be injected and that can sniff out the hydrocarbons from the equipment or from the area. So that's called steam snuffing. Please revise standards regarding instruments and electrical ETC. We'll see that if there's any error. Kindly give example of damage that could occur due to automatic activation. Slide 45. The example is, for example, if there is a fast detection by fire and gas detection system, and that fast detection can activate the suppression, the release of suppression material in the control room, so that could be disastrous. And due to unvalid reason, the extinguishing material has been released, and even though there was no real fire. So the important thing is, in automated system, the accuracy of the system, the reliability of the system, and avoidance of the false alarm and false signals is a challenge. That is basically a message under slide 45. So, hydrant size and fire track 1, any standardization indicate NFPA or other codes? Yes, NFPA 13 and 15 are talking about these systems in clear terms. Next is a guideline for selection of water supply or foam system for storage tanks. NFPA 11 is for foam, 13 and 15 for the spray systems. Next question is, FM20 system shall be considered as a clean agent system. Yes. Can you give example for anywhere where carbon dioxide is used in the refinery? Nowadays, generally no. Previously, it was used, but due to this ozone layer, the CO2 use is being discouraged. With the requirement of service, next question, why room integrity is mandatory? Room integrity is mandatory for clean agents, not a discharge test, while of CO2 system require mandatory discharge test. See, clean agent, if you test, the testing point of view, the release of extinguishing material may not be necessary, but we have to check that, like what are the testing a compulsory requirement of NFPA 11, and accordingly testing is required to be done. At what stage? Next question. See, it is mentioned in the presentation that minimum 1500 GPM water pump with 50% capacity to be used. Please provide its basis. The basis is NFPA 20, which govern the selection of the pumps for a firefighting system. I have a question that a blowdown system is still applicable for depressurization of equipment or emptying out heater tube during the shutdown. It's not a heater tube. Heater tube may not be emptied during the fire scenario, but it is regarding the depressurization of the complete loop. So the heater tube will not be empty. For heater tubes, there's ESD system. First of all, the inlet flow is required to be closed, and then there would be a relief system or a PSVs which should be taking relief action in case pressure is increasing inside the system. Next question is the material extinguishing harm for human beings? See, these are the chemicals, and for example, for a control room, you will need a clean agent, but a human being should not be in the control room at that particular time. Similarly, dry chemicals which are used for extinguishment of fire could be dangerous, and they're basically normally the chemical data sheets should be checked, or safety data sheet should be checked, and for human effects like aura or occupational health related precautions are necessary to be taken care. Is CO2 type really acceptable as a no? In general sense, no, but as a mechanism, it's available in general. What the difference between DLU system and sprinkler system? See, sprinkler system is a part of DLU system generally. DLU is like an overall system, and sprinkler system could be sub part of DLU system. Is it possible to get PPT? We will be putting our presentation on YouTube. This presentation would be available along with some other presentation what we have made. So some presentations we are making available on our YouTube channel, Ovilosity. See, what type of firefighting system should be installed in a package industries? See, in the single line it cannot be answered, but there are various sections of the plant, and accordingly applicable firefighting systems is required to be selected and implemented. So we are already 15 minutes extra than our time, and we try to answer some of the questions. We know all questions could not be answered, and we try to share our material, and further we are available through email, through our correspondence, and we would be willing to share our further information with the participants. And now we have to stop our presentation here. Thank you very much everyone who participated in this session. We hope the information what we shared would be useful for all of you, and we look forward to meeting you in our next webinar. And by then, bye bye. Thank you.